Hi, I'm Carl Zimmer, a columnist for the New York Times, and I'm in conversation with Heather Berlin, a neuroscientist at the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai. So, Heather, I mean, genius is this word that we all use, but I am really curious what people like you think about the word.
Yeah, I guess, well, I mean, I can describe it looking through it, my lens as a neuroscientist. I mean, I think just the word genius is a really all-encompassing term, and what we try to do is kind of break it down into the constituent parts and try to understand the neural mechanisms that drive those things. So, for example, I think a really big part of what it means to be a genius is to have a great deal of creative or like novel thinking, making these novel associations between ideas, having a lot of pattern detection. So it's not just about collecting a bunch of data and knowing a lot of facts, mm-hmm. but it's making these novel connections between ideas. And I think what we want to look at is, for example, what is the neural correlate of something like divergent thinking or thinking outside the box, having novel associations between ideas. And that's the kind of thing that we can begin to measure.
So how can you measure something like that?
So it's been actually quite a problem how to quantify this, not just genius, but let's say creativity. Mm-hmm. We're breaking it down, particularly what I'm interested in is improvisation. So when people are being spontaneously creative. And what we
Why is that important to you? What does that get at?
So I think that a lot of what's happening in the brain is happening outside of awareness. And when we have our sort of conscious brain highly active, it's kind of suppressing a lot of what's going on outside of awareness. And sometimes when people are being creative, they say it almost feels like things are coming from outside of them mm-hmm. when they're in this sort of flow state. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to understand a little bit more about that state. And it seems to be that when people are being creative in the moment, that the part of their brain that has to do with their sense of self, like self-awareness, self-consciousness, is turned down. It's called the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex.
Where is that?
It's sort of like right here. It's part of the prefrontal cortex on on the lateral side.
So you can actually see that change? Like the activity in there is changing in these kinds of situations?
Yeah. So for example, there's been a few studies, and we're doing a new one now, but in the studies all seem to show that, for example, when a jazz musician is improvising mm-hmm. compared to when he does a memorized piece, or even a rapper when he's doing a freestyle rap compared to doing a memorized rap, there's a similar pattern of activation across the improvising rappers and the improvising jazz musicians. And they have a decreased activation in that dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, mm-hmm. which has to do with self-awareness, monitoring your ongoing behavior, making sure it conforms with social norms. But they have also increased activation in a part of the brain called the medial prefrontal cortex, which is sort of like right here, a little, if you go straight back a little bit. And that is turned up, and that has to do with the internal generation of ideas. It's coming from within. It's stimulus independent. So if you think of this state, you're having this sort of free flow of unfiltered information coming from within that's not being inhibited by that dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. You don't have to worry about how do people think about me. And that free flow of information allows for the novel associations to be made. If you think about a similar pattern of brain activation happens during dreams or during daydreaming or some types of meditation or hypnosis, where you lose your sense of self and time and place, and it allows the filter to come off so that novel associations are okay. You know, dreams don't all make sense, but that's where the creativity comes in. So that's why I'm interested in that state, to see what happens in people when they're in that state, because I think that's a big part of what is involved with genius.
So I'm picturing like someone in a scanner rapping, and that's hard to picture. So, I mean, what does this look like? I mean, these experiments are so difficult to set up. I mean, you've figured something out, so how does it work?
Yeah, so what we're doing is, and again, it's hard to make something ecologically valid or sort of simulate what it's like in the real world when you're laying in this, you know, tube and there's this big clicking sound. So what it is, there's a loud clicking noise in the scanner, and we picked a beat that matches the clicking beat in the scanner, you know, so that it's not distracting. And what we do is, in one condition, we have them do a memorized rap. Mm-hmm. And there was a similar study that was done by another group, in a small group of rappers, but we've kind of elaborated on that. And we now, in the improvised state, we show them random images, and they have to improvise and incorporate those images into their rap in real time. And we're giving them real-time audience feedback. So we're having other professional rappers with the dial going up or down. Because that's part of the real world situation. When you're improvising, it's about audience feedback, whether it's comedy improv, theater improv. And we want to see how that feedback affects their sort of creativity.
But how does that feedback and other people, being aware of other people listening to you, how does that connect with your ideas about how these circuits that are involved with the self are coming down when you're being creative? I mean, I would think, like, you know, if you're in that flow state, mm-hmm. you could be performing in front of an empty room because you're just all, it's all about what's coming from within.
Yeah, so what we think is there's something called the default mode network, and that seems to be sort of active. It's sort of a neurocircuit of the brain that's active when your focus of attention is internal. Mm-hmm. So when they're kind of flow state, we see activation of the default mode network. But what we think is that there's occasionally this, they have to monitor their environment, seeing, you know, how am I doing? What is it? So then they'll switch into what's called the executive network, which is looking externally and sort of
so
monitoring the behavior.
So a different net circuit of neurons we're talking about.
Yeah.
We're sort of flipping back and forth.
Yeah, between these two sort of internally focused and generating new ideas and externally focused, kind of to monitor your situation. Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, if you just are having a random flow, it's not like a jazz musician is just playing random notes or a rapper is just saying random words. It has to make sense. You know, it has to be kind of have a certain appeal. And so you do have to monitor at some level. If it's just like a dream state, although it's getting at that novel thinking, it's not necessarily being creative because just random thoughts with making no sense isn't really what we're looking for either. Right. So there's that switching back and forth between the two networks.